Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm hoping that you have managed to get some refreshments and we won't say nourishment, but some goodies on the side. There are some publications that you can pick up. One is Best Books for Children, and the other is Canadian Children's Book News, so those are available for you on the side. So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our National School Library Day colloquia. And it's a great privilege to see so many familiar faces and good friends from various school districts and Vancouver Public Library and from the library school and other schools and educational institutions. National School Library Day Colloquia is our annual school library event, and I'm very pleased to introduce to you the Colloquia series host, who is Luciana Durante from the library school. If you would stand so people know who you are. I want to thank you very much. This particular event is planned in collaboration with the Education Library and the School of Library Archival and Information Science, and also with the Department of Language and Literacy Education. And you may wonder why we have National School Library Day. It dates back actually to 1999, when Blanche Wolves from the International Association for School Librarianship declared that they would have one day a year, but now it's expanded to 1 month a year, where we would honor and celebrate school libraries. And the purpose for doing that was to draw attention to school libraries and also for school library professionals to connect in the world and to remind us about professionalism of school librarianship and education and the importance of school libraries. And so today we're honoring Judy Saltman. And I must say, it's very interesting looking back at the history with respect to National School Library Day. We have managed over years, dating back to 2005, to hold School Library Day events. And Judy has been so key and instrumental in that. She's been a colleague for me here at UBC when I came as a teacher librarian to work in the Education Library, who was so welcoming all those years back. That was in 1982. A long time ago, and I remember that with great fondness. And she has been a staunch supporter of school libraries, from being involved with a founding member of the BC Coalition for School Libraries. As a parent, she was a Friends of the Library for the Vancouver School District, and she certainly has been an advocate here at UBC in terms of supporting our National School Library Day events. On your handout on the back, I've identified our panel presenters, but in addition, some of our National School Library Day events have been webcast, and that's what's happening today. It will be preserved, and these webcast events you can go back to, and I thought there were some really interesting topics covered there. I mean, we had video games and youth with Eric Myers and Kathy Stanford. We had Project Information Literacy with Michael Eisenberg. We had Gauging Youth with Indigenous which included Deborah Martell and Allison Taylor McBride. We had the BC New Education Plan, which featured Patricia Finlay and Gino Bondi. And then we had Connecting Authors and Readers with Vivian Howard. So it's really interesting to take a look back at some of the keynote speakers and take a look at National School Library Day. But what we wanted to do today, Judy, so we wanted to really thank you on behalf of teacher librarians and educators for your support of school libraries. And Judy will be retiring in June, but you have a perpetual invitation to any National School Library Day event that we hold in the future. So join with me in congratulating Judy for all of you. Today. And before I go any further, though, I'm expressing gratitude to Judy. I wanted to I wanted to definitely express our gratitude to the Musqueam people, because UBC is situated on the ancestral and unceded territory of the Musqueam people, and it is a learning place. And so our panel are all people who are contributing to that whole notion of learning and for school libraries. And so I just wanted to introduce to you who the panel members are, and I will introduce them in the order that they're going to speak. So Maggie DeVries, if you could just raise your hand so people know who you are. Maggie DeVries has been influenced by strong women in her life. In particular, if you know of Jean Little, this is one of her aunts, Jean Little, who is a very award-winning Canadian children's writer. Maggie has worked as a children's book editor with Orca Books for 7 years. She also teaches children's literature classes and creative writing classes, and she is a life coach. Some of her children's books include Fraser Bear, A Cub's Life, Tale of a Great White Fish, which one of our students borrowed today because they're looking at sturgeon in the Fraser River, Once a Golden Apple, which has to be fun for those of you who like fractured fairy tales. A dad mixes things up with the fairy tales, and so it's quite an interesting one. And Big City Bees. So for those of us who are working with natural topics, Big City Bees is a great one. Her teen books are extremely riveting and powerful. If you haven't read Rabbit Ears, I would recommend doing so. I found Kaya such a fascinating character and a really interesting character in terms of an adolescent. And then your historical fiction book called Hunger Journeys is also one that I would recommend. She's written an adult memoir called Missing Sarah, A Memoir of Loss. And she has given a TEDx SFU talk, so I would urge you to look that up, called The Red Umbrella, Sex Work, Stigma, and the Law. She is married and has two Burmese cats named Misha and Sophie. So I encourage you to take a look at her website for more information. Jan Hare at the end of the table. Jan is from the Department of Language and Literacy Education. She's an Anishinaabe from the Miching First Nations in Ontario. And she is a first professor in Indigenous education in our Faculty of Education. Her work in the Department of Language and Literacy Education has focused on literacy, family literacy, youth, and First Nations education. Last year, she ran a wonderful reading club for our faculty and students, and she has offered and created a MOOC course that some of you might be interested in on Indigenous education, and that course is in progress right now on edX. So to find out more about Jan Hare, be sure to watch the dialogue with Jan Hare on YouTube. So Jan, and then beside Jan in purple is Yukiko Tosa. Yukiko is head librarian at the Britannia Public Library. She spent her early years in Japan. Her mother was Japanese and her father Japanese-Canadian. Yukiko worked as a teacher librarian in Abbotsford, and she has worked as a children's librarian. And most definitely, she's the most amazing storyteller and origami artist. In her work as a children's librarian, she combined her storytelling and origami to create what are called storygamies. She is an active member of the Vancouver Children's Literature Roundtable and serves on its steering committee. And she has contributed many wonderful lists highlighting wonderful Japanese books for children. So do look up her name and find some of those lists. They're extremely helpful if you're working on with the Japanese folktales. And then Judith Saltman, not last but least, who has been a dedicated scholar to Canadian children's literature, so it seemed extremely important for us with this National School Library colloquia to focus on the place and space for Canadian children's literature in our lives and libraries. She's not only been a wonderful friend, but she is a diligent scholar and has contributed to the scholarship regarding Canadian children's literature in the country, and is really, really highly regarded, not only in Canada, but around the world in terms of her work on Canadian children's literature. So we're really looking forward to hearing from you. So I will be the timekeeper, I guess, and we're going to start with Maggie, and I'm just gonna probably stop this PowerPoint. We'll just get it stopped so that we have it off the screen. Sorry, I'll just...
It's like high tech.
Okay. We'll just escape it, and I'll just get it shut down so we're not having to look at that just at the moment. Okay, sorry. And we'll exit it there, and then yours is down in there. You know how to go get back. Okay, so here is Maggie. You need the mic? Yeah. Super. Thank you.
All right. It's such an honor to be here and to be sitting next to Judy and with Yukiko and Jan and Joanne as well, but to be at an event that's honoring Judy is very, very special to me because Judy has been a wonderful influence in my life and has inspired me a great deal. Okay. I think place is important. I grew up Canadian in the 1960s and 70s, keenly aware of the Canadian identities that were being expressed in the books on my shelves. Lucy Maud Montgomery, Farley Mowat, William Kurelek, Roderick Haig Brown, James Houston, Christy Harris, Mordecai Rickler, Janet Lunn, Myra Paperny, John Hayes, Dennis Lee, Anne Blades, Elizabeth Cleaver, and Shizuye Takashima and Ted Harrison are some of the names of the authors on my shelves. And the books I just showed you are books that I had when I was a child, the actual copies that I had when I was a child. Along with many, many British and American books, I read books by these authors and illustrators, and they taught me that my country was equally worthy of inclusion in literature, that my history and my experience could be represented in books, and equally important, that people, kind of like me, had been writing books for decades. I was taught right from the start that I should always know authors' names along with the titles of the books that I loved. That was a rule in my household. Thus, writers and books were inextricably linked for me. Many of the Canadian books on my shelves came from my aunt, Jean Little, whose first book was published the year after I was born, and whose third book, Spring Begins in March, is dedicated to my mother and to me, to Patsy, who turned into Meg, and to Meg, who turned into Maggie. That's me. Aunt Jean gave me books long before I was ready to read them. She gave me new books, and she gave me old books. Many of the books on my shelves were inscribed with her name decades before she inscribed them to me. Aunt Jean says that every child should have access to 5 libraries: the public library, the school library, the classroom library, the family library, and her own library. I am certain that I started to write in large part because of those books, all those 5 libraries, and that aunt. Looking back, though, my early writing was not very Canadian. In grade 6, I wrote something I thought of as a novel. It felt long to me. It had chapters. It also had an evil uncle, straight out of The Babes in the Wood, a nanny, straight out of Mary Poppins, a pair of orphaned children, perhaps from a combination of The Secret Garden, A Little Princess, and The Wolves of Willoughby Chase. A huge mansion, also probably from Joan Aiken, with a secret staircase leading down, down, down into a dungeon filled with skeletons, influenced, I think, by Bluebeard. Nothing Canadian there. When I was 26, living in Mexico, I had a dream about strange horse creatures that led me in the years that followed to write several hundred pages of a novel. That book, never completed, was set partly in Spain in the 16th century, partly in Mexico City at the convent of Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz, partly in 2 fantasy worlds, one of them populated by horses with front legs that ended in large hands instead of hooves, and partly in the Toronto of the mid-80s. Ah, Canada. I was living in Guelph as I was writing that book, so Toronto made excellent sense as a setting, though Guelph might have been even better. And so did Mexico City, as when I spent time there, I was inspired by the stories of Sor Juana. Through all those growing up and grown-up years, I went right on reading Canadian children's books. I still do, of course. While I was living in Guelph, and still in my 20s, Aunt Jean and I team-taught children's literature courses at the university. We invited Robert Munch to our classes, and Wellen Wilton Katz, and Janet Lunn, and Barbara Smucker. When I moved back to Vancouver in 1990, I taught here, and my immersion continued. I met my husband-to-be in 1992, and he owned a boat. So now we shift from the books to the land, the water. He took me to Desolation Sound, and a time travel novel took shape for me, set partly on a small island near Quadra Island and partly in Vancouver. That book has yet to find a home. A few years later, I was lying awake one night when a series of animals spoke invitations straight into my mind. The next day, I wrote a story about a girl who lies awake like I did and hears from animals from this part of the world, a whale, an eagle, a horse with hooves, a frog, a rabbit, a seal, and last and best of all, her very own cat. That story became How Sleep Found Tabitha. I grew up a few blocks from Spanish Banks, but I live now just up the hill from the Fraser River. Daily, at dusk, I watch endless crows stream north across that river, and those crows made their way into Somebody's Girl. I was invited to write a book about sturgeon, and now I get to imagine the massive creatures swimming right alongside me as I walk the river. I was invited to write a book about a bear cub and salmon, and I decided that Fraser Bear would live 1,300 kilometers away from me near the headwaters of that same river where the Chinook spawn. I don't set books in Canada so that children will learn about their country, or so they will see themselves represented in stories, or so they will realize that they too can be and become writers, even though I'm glad of all those things. I set stories in Canada because these particular stories demand to be set here. Sturgeon and bears and bees don't care what country they're in, but place matters to them more than anything. So I have set my animal stories in particular places. I wrote about bees downtown, and because of my connection to the downtown east side, I set part of the story right down on the harbor at the foot of Main Street in Crab Park. I told my illustrator, Rene Benoit, about the big orange giraffe-like cranes down there, and I sent her photos so she would include them. The publisher thought those cranes might confuse the reader, but I wanted them there so much that I fought for them, and there they are, on the page, representing a truth of the Crab Park experience, even though the community garden I placed in Crab Park is fictional. The flexibility of the fiction writer is a marvelous thing. My latest book, Rabbit Ears, also has a scene in Crab Park on the there. The book is set in West Point Grey and the downtown east side with a first chapter on Hornby Island. For me, the specificity, and I hope the truth of those settings, help to ground the story in this real world, this place where we are. I think that specificity in books helps to make them universal. That specificity helps me as a writer speak to readers both familiar and unfamiliar with the places in my stories. I have a new picture book coming out with Orca, set along the Fraser, out in Georgia Strait, and in a small bay off one of the Gulf Islands. None of those places is named in the story. Names would have felt obtrusive, but that doesn't mean that this coast and that water aren't important in the story. Swimming with Seals is set here, and an author's note will tie the story to this place even more firmly. Back when I was working with teachers, they often wanted to talk about what makes a book Canadian. For me, the answer couldn't be simpler. Canadian books are books created by Canadians. A book by a new Canadian writing about a place she comes from is just as Canadian as a book by a fifth-generation Canadian set in the northern wilderness, and just as Canadian as a picture book set in a fantasy world. I think that it's important for young readers to see that a multiplicity of Canadians can and do write about whatever it is that speaks to them. I started off by saying I think place is important. I spoke about my own journey into using local settings in my work. I'd like to end with a different take on place. I'm a writer, and Canada is my place. It's not the settings of my stories that make my work Canadian. It's me. Thank you.
Miigwech, thank you for the invitation to join such a creative and accomplished group of people. So I'm very delighted to be part of this. When I was asked to join this panel, there were several questions that were posed to us to answer. So I chose to pick a question specifically and look at why should we care about Canadian children's literature in our lives and in our libraries. And if you look at, well, what brings me to this topic are several things. I teach a course on Indigenous storytelling traditions in education, so working with educators to support how they may take up these traditions in their classroom. And as Joanne mentioned, I also have developed a MOOC. It's a massive open online course, and it's entitled Reconciliation Through Indigenous Education. And reconciliation has been a very critical movement here in Canada in order to foster and build and sustain positive and respectful relationships between Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal peoples, as we've had a very difficult but also shared history. That this the work of the TRC asks us to reflect on, and I also would say act on. And I like this picture. You'll see these signs throughout on our campus where British Columbia, today your host is, and it names one of the First Nations here in British Columbia. If you look at it, British Columbia today is spelt backwards. And this is an exhibition that was done by Edward Heap of Birds, and so these signs are to ask us to disrupt our thinking, really. So to disrupt our thinking about Indigenous peoples and about place. So how do we come to know what we know about Indigenous peoples? And these signs then challenge us to do that. And so I think the work of the Truth and Reconciliation as well is asking us to disrupt our thinking. How have we come to know what we know about Indigenous peoples? Because that has really impacted on our relationship, our relationship together. So Canada, like Australia, New Zealand, and the United States, are certainly countries founded on colonial relations or colonial encounters with Indigenous people. And it's a history, and I would say a shared history, that has produced very different outcomes for Indigenous and settler newcomers in this country. So these encounters have produced a set of narratives about Indigenous settler relationships, and I would also say a national identity as a whole, that has been somewhat problematic for us, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples. And these are just a few examples from some books, thinking about the notion of terra nullius, which has justified settler colonialism, if you will, thinking that the land here was this vast empty expanse and that there actually weren't people here prior to that. So I think about the book Brother Eagle, Sister Sky, and it promotes this kind of narrative of the vanishing race, that people here, that there weren't really people here prior to contact. And I also think about, the novel or the story of Pocahontas, and again, reproducing these kinds of narratives of a cooperative, peaceful coexistence or settlement of Canada, and that certainly hasn't been the case. Sorry, I need to move this down. Oh, I guess I'll just move on to the next one. And so the Truth and Reconciliation has hosted a set of events across Canada over the last few years, bringing together residential school survivors. So the focus of the TRC has been looking at this history of schooling and in particular residential schooling, and has delivered its final report. It delivered a final report, very emotional time in June in Ottawa, in Canada's national capital. And it produced a set of recommendations, 94 recommendations, or calls to action as they are calling them. And they are to look at, or the recommendations are to ensure that educators, teachers, and I would say all Canadians, all students, have an opportunity to learn about Canada's Aboriginal peoples through their histories, their worldviews, their contemporary realities. And so the commission makes a set of recommendations around changing the curriculum of schooling, changing the way we educate teacher educators and professionals. And I would think about libraries as part of that. And so I think a really important set of texts that are growing and certainly emerging are residential school texts that tell the story of residential schools through the eyes of young people. And I think these texts, certainly there's a growing number of these accounts that are contributing to our understanding of Indigenous histories, as well as that relationship and that shared colonial history. And these texts are important because they help help young people reflect critically on the enduring legacy of colonization. So not only that this is a history that existed, but that there are intergenerational there's an intergenerational legacy. There are intergenerational impacts that are still ongoing for Indigenous peoples. And certainly helps others to think about their relationship to Indigenous people by looking at this history and what do we understand about this history. It's, you know, working with teacher educators, it's, you know, how many are surprised that they didn't learn about this in their own schooling. They talk about that. That this was not a history that they were aware of, or they never really understood the impacts of this history. And while I would say residential schools are not the whole of our history and not the whole of our colonial history here in Canada, residential schools really play a role in understanding for educators, and I think all Canadians really, how our family, young children and families participate in schools. And so, again, why I think these texts are a really important read for all Canadians is the questions as the question that I've started out with. I tried to answer this one. And also how can, these texts ask us to look at how Canadians have benefited from colonization. And I think that's a really difficult process for many, certainly for young people, but all of us as Canadians to think about is we have inherited this colonial history, we have benefited from this colonial history, and so what does that mean? How do we act upon that? And I'm just going to conclude with, I'm thinking about Tom King's narrative here, this narrative frame that he uses at the end of each of the five Massey lectures. So Tom King's, I forget the name now, his Massey lecture, oh here we go, The Truth About Stories. And so at the end of each of the lectures he says, don't say in the years to come that you would have lived your life differently if only you had heard this story, you've heard it now. And what I appreciate about this, and also I would suggest the work of Dr. Archibald, is that it talks about the, sorry to disrupt everyone's train of thought here, but I'm just looking to how to scroll down on this end part of the PowerPoint. Okay, I thought we had to go over here and then Sorry. But I feel like King, like Archibald, reminds us that stories carry with them social and moral responsibilities. And these stories, such as those found in residential school texts, but and residential school literature, allows for all of us to consider what those responsibilities might be, given the past lives, or well, really get them, given that the past lives on for Indigenous peoples. who live with continued colonial violence, and that Canadians need to consider how they will come to terms with their with our relationship as Indigenous and non-Indigenous people. So, and I think this connects to many of the larger issues that are taking place in our society. You know, thinking about Idle No More as an more as a political, environmental, and social concern. Thinking about Canada's murder of innocent women. And so I think this relationship is really connected to these larger societal issues that we have here in Canada. So, okay. Thanks. Sorry.
We're just switching over. So while we're switching over, I just wanted to thank Judy because I think I was one of her very first students, very first library school student. So it ages me, but she taught me a lot. So I must say it's been wonderful. And it is a real honor to be here, to be with you. So thank you, Judy. Thank you. Okay, let me just get the slideshow going. Okay, I think we did it right here from the beginning. Okay, all right, so as Joanne mentioned, I'm the branch head right now at the Britannia branch, but I did spend 16 years of my life as a children's librarian first, so I'll never forget that that is still a very important part of my life, and I'll never forget how Judy was very good at teaching us about Canadian children's literature too, so that's always been embedded in my head. Well, now I'm at Britannia Branch as their branch head. I'm heading towards retirement myself, and I just wanted to show you a little bit of some of the things that we do at our branch, plus a different perspective on Canadian children's literature from my own experiences. So first of all, this is Britannia at 1661 Napier Street on Napier and Commercial Drive, and we're part of the Grandview Woodlands community. Who we are, we opened this branch in 1975, and it's a joint elementary, secondary, and public library. It's nearly 40 years old. And I have a very special affinity to this because this is my high school. And what's really interesting is there was no library when I grew up. When I was 16, our very, very social political social studies teacher got all of us 16-year-olds involved, and we went door-to-door collecting signatures from the neighborhood and then taking it to City Hall to say, we want a community center, we want an elementary school, and we want a public library in our space. And so in 1975, this is what happened. And now it's a joint operating agreement between Vancouver Public Library, the Vancouver School Board, and the Britannia Community Services. And we all work together to do all kinds of things together. So this was what I was wanting to say. So here we are as a joint place where K to 12 students come. Plus, we are a public library, so there are babies all over the place, as well as seniors that come as well. So we do all kinds of things, and I'm finding it's going to be a really lovely full circle for myself as I retire pretty soon to be able to end my career in my own high school and in this setting. Also, it houses a community art gallery, if you didn't know that. There is a Britannia Community Art Gallery because in our community we have incredible artists. So every month we showcase an artist from the community, and we have a launch every first Wednesday of each month. So you're welcome to come. There's really great food, too. And then we all work together to support a sense of belonging to our community, and we provide it with a variety of resources and a flexible, creative approach to make library services and programs accessible. So some of the highlights, we have a very diverse and changing community. When I grew up, it was mainly Chinese and Italians. We had a few black students, but we hardly had any Aboriginal students. But now we have an incredible amount, and we're really proud of them, and we want to support them in their education as well. We have Vietnamese, Latino as well, of all adults, children, youth, and seniors, and a lot of immigrant families too. And as I said, some of you may know about the East Side Culture Crawl, which is happening in November, and you will know that there's a lot of artists living between Strathcona and Britannia. So we hope you come and join and see all the artists' works. The branch is committed to reducing barriers, and we create an environment that's welcoming and balances the needs of the community. Some of the challenges as a joint school and public library is that this shared space, there is actually no teaching area on the library floor. We now have a little tiny room that the ESL people have now vacated, so we're using that as a teaching place as well. We also have different mandates in the purchasing of curriculum support materials. And Thomas is here from our selections team at VPL. He can vouch for that. And also, we have a lot of high-risk, unattended youth. And this goes all the way to the students, I mean, the people that are about in their 20s. And sometimes it's really hard to deal with them. And we have homeless people that come into our library, too. So it's a mix of interesting combinations of people. Some of the benefits, though, is that we have access to more funding for the collection, because if you're just a school library, you don't have the amount of money that you might have as a public library. So together, we have more of a variety. We also can share resources and access wider comprehensive collections and electronic resources. For example, VSB carries a lot of great electronic databases, but so does the Vancouver Public Library. So combined together, we are offering the students a lot more opportunity to experience those databases. And right now we're trying to launch a noon hour kind of come and learn our new databases at VPL for the teachers so that they can see what we have and we can introduce it to them. So in many ways, we have the shared commitment to having a strong Canadian children's literature. Because we work together, I have a teacher librarian in the elementary school who comes 2 days a week. We have a secondary teacher librarian that comes every day. We're kind of worried for her too, because the situation in Vancouver is very volatile, especially in the education field. So I don't know if I can keep her for every single day, but I hope we can. But we work together to talk about new books, and especially Canadian books, and what are there, because we have a diverse community, and we want to provide all those different resources that children can identify themselves with. So this is my version from a Japanese-Canadian perspective of the Canadian children's literature. I grew up in the late 50s and 60s, so we can tell the age difference, right? And I grew up in the Strathcona and Britannia communities. My father was born in Steveston, and after the war, most of my family were in Greenwood. They were interned there. And at the end of the war, the Japanese Canadians were allowed to do two things. They could either go back east or they could go to Japan. My father's family decided to go to Japan, and he met my mother there. And because they were all poor and starving over there, he went to work for the U.S. military. So I was born in a U.S. military base in Kokura City in Kyushu. And I couldn't understand why I had all these pictures of myself and GI soldiers. But that was one of the reasons. And then in the late 1940s, that was when the Canadian government allowed the Japanese Canadians to come back to the West Coast. So that was when a whole bunch of Japanese Canadians returned from Japan and from back east to settle in Vancouver on Alexander Street and Powell Street. So I grew up on Powell Street. And at that time in the 50s, it was an incredibly vibrant community of all of us there celebrating our culture and doing all kinds of things, and then going to Strathcona and also later to Britannia. At that time, there were only school libraries. There wasn't a public library joined with the school library. My closest public library was the Central Library as well as the Hastings branch. So I used to go there all the time. In my school library, because I was a school monitor and determined to read every single book in the library, starting from Alcott with A, I discovered that there was Lucy Maud Montgomery. Oh, this was about, I kind of realized that this is a Canadian book by a Canadian author. So that was really great. But there was no representation in print at that time, including textbooks, about the Japanese-Canadian experience. So what happened was the key influences in my life, so I'm sorry it's kind of small, but for me it was Japanese folklore. And one of the greatest writers of translators of Japanese folklore was Yoshiko Uchida, who was an American Japanese. And she translated a lot of fabulous books, including The Dancing Kero and other Japanese folktales back in 1949, and she did so with several others. Also, there were classic picture books by Taro Iishima, like Crow Boy and Umbrella, where I could sort of look at it and go, oh, this child looks like me, you know, that kind of thing. And then my mother. My mother was the biggest influence because she was a real prolific reader and an incredible storyteller. But her storytelling was mainly didactic because she was trying to teach me what was good and wrong. But I think in a lot of communities and in a lot of cultures, that's used to teach us something, so that deductive form of storytelling. Then the environment shifted a little bit, so that in 1971, there were two major books about the internment that came to my attention. Yoshiko Uchida, who did the folklore, she wrote a story about herself and about the Japanese-American internment called Journey to Topaz. And then in Canada, as you mentioned, Shizue Takashima wrote a book called A Child in Prison Camp, and it was about the Japanese-Canadian internment. And she was an artist and taught back east, and she retired to the Kerrisdale area when after she retired. And I had a chance to talk with her and chat with her before she passed away, and it was really, she was such an inspiration. And then, again, with the shifting environment, in the 70s and 80s, there were more series books, but they were about samurais, about, you know, with Catherine Patterson's series, Eric Hogarth's series, and Lindsay Namioka, who is actually a Chinese-American, married to a Japanese-American. But they were historical novels about Japan and not really about my own experience. So then along came Shelley Tanaka's book called Michi's New Year. And it's a tiny little book, but it made a big impression on me because it was about a young Japanese girl who misses the New Year she used to celebrate in Japan. But then she thinks, where's my place in this big country of Canada? So that was the first time I could identify with something like that. Then the key factors in the 1980s, the Japanese-Canadian redress agreement started. And the 1980s marked the rejuvenation of the fight for redress, bolstered by the Japanese-American agreement. And in September 22, 1988, this agreement was signed and gained the support of many Canadians from all walks of life from Canada. So if you ever want to hear about or read about the history of that agreement, I've got a link here as well. So all of a sudden, people were talking about the redress and about the agreements. So as that happened, we had a lot of books about the Japanese-Canadian experience, first for adults and then for children. So Joy Kogawa's book of Obasan came out in 1981, which later became a children's book called Naomi's Road in 88, and then Naomi's Tree in 2008. Then Alan Fujiwara and Tom McNeely and the Momiji Healthcare Society in Toronto wrote a book called Bachan Jichan Arigato, which is this one, a tiny little book thanking their grandparents because of what they had gone through in the war. And then the growth continued. So in 1990s, all of a sudden, non-Japanese Canadians were writing about the Japanese Canadian internment from their perspective. So there was like The Eternal Spring of Mr. Ito, Eric Walters' War of the Eagles, and his sequel, Caged Eagles, which really has more about the Japanese Canadian experience, and Maxine Trottier's Flags. So there's more, but I didn't want to overburden you guys. But anyways, this is the highlights for me. And then in 2000, I wanted to bring up Suki's Kimono, because Suki's Kimono is not about the internment, but it's about a little girl who goes to a festival and is dressed up in a yukata, a summer clothes, you know, summer kimono, and she's dancing on the streets and what that yukata means. And this is the one book that reminds me of my growing up on Powell Street, because every August for the Moon Festival, the Japanese Canadian children would get to dress up in their yukatas and dance in front of the Buddhist church at Oppenheimer Park. and we were able to eat ice, shaved ice. And this was the one Canadian book that talked about my experience. And it was written in 2003. So I thought, that's amazing. And then later on, we have other ones about the internment. And this time, A Time for Courage. There's also a part of our Canadian Girls series, which I think is really great because it's focusing on our Canadian girls and all different kinds of histories. The Sakura Tree as well. And, am I going backwards? Yeah, here we go. And then there was also Jennifer Maruno's book, When the Cherry Blossoms Fell. And Jennifer Maruno talks about her mother-in-law, because she's not Japanese-Canadian, but her mother-in-law is. And she talks about her internment experiences in the Cherry Blossoms series. And then Susan Ayoshi wrote a wonderful book called Torn Apart, The Internment Diary of Mary Kobayashi. And it's the Dear Canada series in 2012. And Mary Kobayashi grew up in the downtown east side, went to Templeton High School, and then got interned. So it's a very interesting book done in diary format. So if you're really interested in reading it, it's a fabulous book. And then, as it continued in 2000, now we're writing textbooks, as we talked about. And this is one of the ones called Writing Canada's Wrongs. And it covers a lot of different cultures that have experienced prejudice and hardships in Canada. And this one is done by Pamela Hickman and Masako Fukawa, called Japanese Canadians Internment in the Second World War, mainly targeted school and even grade 7 students. So I really, really like that book. And of course, Masako has worked very closely with the Japanese Nikkei National Museum and Cultural Center, which opened in September 22, 2000 in Burnaby. And it has a museum, it has primary sources. We're always collecting photos and even suitcases and even what life was like in the internment camps. And there they have all kinds of programs, exhibits, services, publications for teachers and students about the Japanese Canadian experience, and they do tours for schools as well. So that's part of it. But what about the future? This is the last one. There is a lot of growth of Japanese Canadian and American authors in all genres now. So Canadian authors such as Hiromi Goto, Shara Levine, Raymond Nakamura, Ruth Ohi, Michael Emiko Uchi, Roy Miki, Yuka Shimada, and Mariko Tamaki. And they don't write necessarily about the Japanese-Canadian experience. They write about books, about themselves, and graphic novels. And so it's kind of neat to see that integration happening. And even among American authors, there's people like Kinuko Kraft, Felicia Hoshino, Cynthia Kadohata, Julie Kagawa, who writes fantasy, Kazu Kibushi, who does graphic novels to the Amulet series, Amy Lee Tai, she's very interesting because she's half Chinese and half Japanese. And it's her maternal grandparents that were entered in Topaz, which is the same place that we heard about with Joshiko Uchida. And then Judy Otsuka, Kim Mochizuki, and Alan Say, of course. So what I'm finding with people like that, with people like Amy, who now are in the fourth and third and fourth generation, they call themselves the Hapa generation because it's a mix not just of one culture, but a mix of varieties of cultures. And they're looking at the world in a different set of eyes. They want to identify themselves too, but at the same time, we're part of an integral part of this society and this Canada. And it's interesting to see books about those kids who are named Yoko, like with Rosemary Wells, and they may have those kinds of Japanese names, but they are Canadians or Americans living in this country. And I really appreciate the fact that we're seeing that integration happening together to see that we are all made up of many cultures. And in our library, we get really excited when parents and children come and borrow a book about other cultures in Canada. And we say, oh, that's a really great book, and we really appreciate the fact that parents are sharing the stories about the history of Canada through a book, and through a picture book, or through a story. So that's my take on what it means to have a Canadian, you know, place and space for Canadian literature. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I want to take a moment to thank Joanne Naslund for for organizing this really beautiful event. I personally love it. And these wonderful speakers, all of you, from the heart. I'm from the heart, and I don't have enough time, but as you see. So I'm going to take it anyway. After all, I'm retiring in June. What can anyone do? So I thought I would know what I wanted to say, but I didn't, so I wrote it down. And it will be about 10 minutes. And I hope there's time for questions. And stay anyway, even if you need to leave. So thank you, everyone, for coming and for your fascinating perspectives. So I'm speaking from, Joanne asked me to, from my research. My research has always addressed the question of cultural identity of nations. As revealed in children's literature and shared with the children of a nation, it is a complex concept that involves the constructions of national identity, which shifts and changes across time, and the place that children's literature holds in relation to an adult literature and society. The discovery of selfhood is a very strong element in writing for children, and it incorporates questions of what we might call cultural address. And I call that the space and place where one feels at home, and the experiences of identification by which cultural belonging and national identity are formed. But how nations define themselves, as you have heard today, and construct, deconstruct, and reconstruct cultural identity changes across time, as elements such as colonization, post-colonialism, independence, immigration, cultural pluralism, globalization, and transcultural experiences alter the self-defining identity, or sometimes identities, of the society. In 1967, a few of us here were alive then, during Canada's centennial year, when issues of Canadian cultural production were being broadly discussed by the intelligentsia and the media, critics such as Sheila Egoff argued that children's books can show the reader aspects of Canadian identity and Canadian cultural values, and I would say a nation's literature can be seen as a reflection of the values, tensions, myths, and psychology that identify a national character, or characters, plural. Canada has undergone profound societal changes since the 1960s. Government policies on immigration, bilingualism, multiculturalism deeply influenced Canadian children's literature. The diversity of contemporary Canadian society today makes national identity formation in Canada a set of conversations rather than a finite goal. If one of the roles of children's literature in Canada is to show readers aspects of Canadian cultural identity, how on earth does our literature for children reflect these multifaceted, multiple identities? So my co-researcher Gail Edwards and I conducted up to 2010, which I realize is a long time ago now, 136 interviews, 136, for our book called Picturing Canada, A History of Canadian Children's Illustrated Books and Publishing. And I'd like to share with you a sampling of what, not 136 interviewees said, but quite a nice number, about this country's cultural print history and literary vision for its children. So the children's writers and editors in the 50s and the 60s in Canada had profound difficulty in developing a climate in which Canadian children's books could compete successfully with American and British imports. The nationalism of the baby boom generation was distinctly literary. It linked the ideas of print consumption with identity formation, think Dennis Lee and Margaret Atwood. It was this belief that shaped the formation of the independent children's Canadian publishers in the 1970s and 80s and sustained a struggle of creators and publishers, critics and readers, teacher librarians and public librarians to create a distinctly Canadian children's literary culture. And the very same thing was happening in Australia and New Zealand at this time. I think I've cut this, excuse me. Author Janet Lunn explained, we're in the interviews now, that in the 1970s, she would go into schools and no one would have read Canadian books. The teachers and librarians would say, oh, I never read Canadian. That's her voice. Author and illustrator Ian Wallace noted the change and said, the 1970s were an exhilarating time. We felt there was a real possibility of establishing a vibrant Canadian children's literature that reflected the lives of Canadian kids. Former publisher Pat Cialdana of Groundwood Books commented on how rare it was to publish Canadian children's books at all. She said, I'm interested in high-quality books that have a strong political message. I think initially publishing Canadian books was a political issue in and of itself. Author Tim Wynne Jones discussed the funding and politics of the era, and you'll like the reference to politics here. In the 1970s, a certain Canadian prime minister named Pierre Trudeau opened the coffers and said, come on kids, invent Canada. And so we did on a thousand fronts. And it turned out that Canadians were thrilled to discover we had this homegrown culture just waiting to happen. Over the course of the next few decades, the vision of Canada expressed in the books transformed beyond its earlier limiting reflection of a Eurocentric Canada. In 1980, one major force was the establishment of Aboriginal-owned publishing houses, which resulted in stories and narratives by Canada's original peoples, rather than stories about them by non-Aboriginal authors. I interviewed author Richard Van Camp of the Dog Rib Nation, who explained, why I became an author is very interesting and simple. Nobody was writing the stories that I wanted to read. Nobody was writing about what I saw, the stories about my life and experience, what I felt, what I heard, what I sensed. Cree author and illustrator George Littlechild, who you may know as a fine artist, commented, I try to reflect the themes of the First Nations experience, that culturally we have survived, that we have risen above our historical experiences, and this society has a lot to learn from First Nations culture and peoples. So cultural diversity in its many aspects developed as a strong presence in Canadian children's books from its beginnings, but to this day, as you heard from Yukiko, despite the commitment to diversity, there are still issues of an underlying deficit in numbers and quality and the need of a consistent and ongoing publishing mandate to bring forth texts of diversity of culture. In my interview with author Paul Yee, his words were echoed by other interviewees when he said, I am on the margins in my writing as a Chinese Canadian. I am part of the voices that are trying to say that Canadian literature is not only about white middle-class families in the big cities. What I want to convey most is diverse people's needs to tell their own stories from their own points of view with themselves in the center. The construction of a sense of identity across regions, languages, cultures, and landscapes resonated with all the people I interviewed. The issue of what you might call the specificity of language used to describe what Maggie called specific place, and I call space in books, was a recurring theme. Patsy Aldana, the publisher, also commented the following. Your whole idea of the world is shaped by the images and the words that you encounter when you are very young. If they all come from outside, and by this she meant outside Canada, then the children are culturally misplaced. Author Sarah Ellis, who lives here in Vancouver, said, it's a wonderful moment of recognition when you go to a place and you know it because you've read about it. English and American children have had this for generations, if not centuries. We are just starting to get this feeling in Canada. It gives you a literary familiarity. If we are going to survive as a country, she said, I think it is essential. In the last 20 years, changes to the publishing industry took place in Canada and around the world as firms moved into the international marketplace. There was a huge need to compete in the global marketplace in order to survive financially because the domestic markets had become flat. And this brought challenges, it brought opportunities, but terrible challenges. The widely held belief by many publishers that distinctive regional and national markers or identifiers in Canadian children's books would lessen the possibility of international sales into the American market and around the world has arguably changed children's publishing in Canada in the last 20 years. In a global market, the question is, can and should Canadian publishers retain distinctively Canadian images, language, terms, markers? Bob Terrell of Orca Book Publishers argues that it should matter that his publishing house continues to contribute to the cultural education of our children, as he says, by publishing books written and illustrated by Canadian authors and illustrators and set in Canadian cities and towns, at least some of them. But for author Cheryl McFarlane, who lives on Vancouver Island, it is more important to explore the relationships between characters and place and capture emotion than give specific and identifiable place names in the text. On the other hand, she said to me, she actively resisted attempts on the part of her American publisher to anthropomorphize the relationship between humans and whales, saying, they wanted the whales to be friendlier. Maybe Americans want the whales to be friendlier, but these are wild animals, and we know that here. Critic Ronald Jobe from UBC is concerned that the very commonplaces and cultural identifiers that adults and children have identified as significant in Canadian children's books are disappearing as a result of the homogenized globalization. So this has taken place with every country that publishes children's books. Homogenization for the global market and particularly Americanization of Canadian publishing. There is research, in fact, so I'm going to end on a kind of gloomy note, that explores the reading habits of young adults and the severing of links between youth, reading, and citizenship, which argues that the powerful discourses of cultural nationalism that shaped the attitudes of the Canadian generation that came of age in the 1960s and 70s are no longer seen as relevant in a globalized economy. Publishers must sell into that international marketplace to ensure continued survival, we know that. And it's an irrefutable fact that will undoubtedly continue to shape what is published for children into the future. But acknowledging this imperative, I just leave you with a question. Is it possible that for the next generation of children, the question of whether, and adults, the question of whether it is important that Canadian children see themselves in the books they read, that question may have become totally irrelevant. So thank you very much. We're so happy you came.
Thanks so much for coming today. Joanne asked me to say a few concluding words and to thank our distinguished panel of speakers. I have noted the irony that they asked the American to come up and conclude the session on Canadian children's literature. Noted. Thanks for bearing with me anyway. I was scribbling in the back because I never have the words that I want to say ready, but I anticipated that these four would inspire me, and indeed they did, as I'm sure they inspired you with their remarks on how children's literature and stories have impacted their lives. And since this is School Library Day colloquium, I was thinking, of course, with my former school librarian hat on. And really, what struck me is how much a school library is a multi-lifespan information system. It really is something that allows us to tell our stories across generations. And so really what school libraries do is they help us help young people situate their own narratives within the larger narratives that are of their families, of their schools, are of their communities, of their nations, really those specific places that they own, that are theirs. And so those stories document the past, but they also provide a link to the future for those young people. They really give readers a frame for understanding today and yesterday, but they also open up new possibilities for tomorrow, which is really exciting. As Judy was saying, it's the literary vision for our children, which is really exciting. Now, I really want to thank these four distinguished speakers for their deeply personal stories. I was touched by every one of them. Narratives of home and away, of colonization and displacement, but also of pride and of heritage and of belonging. And each generation has its own contribution to these narratives. And it's our responsibility to ensure that these stories are preserved, that they're shared, that they're celebrated, that they're criticized, but they're ultimately added to by subsequent generations. And so this is our call, this is our responsibility, our onus to go out there and add to the story and encourage kids to go out there and write the next chapter for Canada. So thank you very much for coming.
Questions,
and now it's question time.
Maybe one or two questions.
Questions. I also get to be question man with the microphone. This is so exciting. Anyone? Anyone?
Okay, Judy concluded her talk about asking whether it will be relevant in the future. I would like to ask that question to that lady about the Japanese heritage and stories about it. Do you think that 20 years from now it will be so absorbed and so understood that it will not be so important, or do you think that it will be more important?
Coming back.
You're absolutely right, because we don't know in the next maybe two or three generations whether I think that the relevancy is still there, because historically we need to know our culture and what happened here, just like we cannot now forget what happened with our First Nations and Aboriginal peoples, because that's our history, that's our past. And I know the children, especially of the generation where they're mixed with the Hapa generation, they themselves are really seeking, because they're it's just like any other person that has Scottish, Irish, you know, French and all that mixed inside of them. They want to know a little bit about their past and what happened. And our past shapes us in many ways. So I think it's important that we still have that literature, and that I think that a lot of them are seeking, and I know they're seeking now. So I think in 20 years or 30 years, they'll still be seeking, because they want to know who they are. Because I have a really, she's like my sister. She's married to a German, and her little boy is half German, half Japanese. And he said to me one day when he was 7, "What am I?" You know, so what are you? You're a really lovely combination of being German and Japanese. There's a lot of history there, so that's what I feel.
One of the quotes that Judy shared was about someone mentioned it's not important to name place. And I was thinking, Jan, particularly of you, when we're talking about naming place and naming this place, how important do you see it as actually naming places here in Canada?
Oh, sorry.
I think there is a whole politics around naming and of renaming, especially for Aboriginal people here in Canada who are reclaiming land, reclaiming stories. You know, I even think about the history of UBC and the development here and how, you know, the very recognition of the Musqueam territory, how we're seeing places being renamed here on campus that have been buried under UBC development. And so I do think that the naming and the renaming is part of that reclamation of identity and of Indigenous rights, and very much connected to land and place.
Come on, one more. Have to have a nice even on even three. There we go.
My question comes from the perspective of a school librarian. How would you recommend that a school librarian go about promoting Canadian children's literature to teachers who are faced with maybe whatever resources are available in the school that may or may not be Canadian? So how do we get that importance across to teachers?
This question is for two people, Daniel, right? For me and then Yukiko. I think the only way you convey information is by communicating. And all the publishers I spoke to, Canadian publishers, said they were losing their conduit that would carry the information about their books into the school, into the library, and to the teachers in elementary and high schools because of the cutbacks to school library budgets and teacher librarians. And they were losing the only secure way they had to let the teachers know what was out there that they could use in their classrooms. So I think what's going on with provincial governments and municipal school boards has been a nightmare over the last 15, almost 20 years. And the teacher librarians have been decimated. Some of them are here and they're standing up. They haven't been cut down yet. But maybe they would like to address that question. What I can see is that organizations like the Vancouver Children's Literature Roundtable have for decades stepped in to assist with that education of teachers. And I also think universities and the faculties of education should have a required course in children's literature, and I don't believe any do. That's my comment.
And I know that one of the things that we really need to do too for the public libraries is we do have a wonderful resource in the public children's librarians, and we have great people that are selectors who look and review resources that are there. And I think we need to work in partnership with the teacher librarians and help them, because they may know things. I know some teacher librarians who are phenomenal readers and have so much knowledge too, just as much as our children's librarian. And it's that dialogue time that we need to do and spend, and then really conscientiously say we need to buy this book, but also look at it from a critical eye to say, is it something that's really worthy of us to really read and share with our children and our students? So that's one of the things. It's really education and sharing together, you know. And now we have a whole MACO program. And we have not just that, but we've got the, you know, librarians, we've got teacher librarians, and I think we need to get together and preserve that and work together to share that knowledge and to make sure that we have that there. And encourage our kids to write. You know, we have Canadian kids that, you know, we see every day, and we have book camps in the summer at the library, and we have summer reading clubs, and, you know, and the teachers are so wonderful in teaching the teacher librarians and telling the kids, write. So I think we need to encourage that as well.
I, I would also ask us to think about rethinking text and what do we mean by text, because I think Indigenous narrative traditions have lots to offer libraries as well. We see that in the Vancouver Public Libraries, Indigenous storyteller in residence. I know you all talked about, you know, books that were on your shelves, and I think about stories in the shelves of my mind. It was, you know, it was my grandmother, it was James Turner, it was Jane Friday, it was, you know, those were the elders and the storytellers in our communities who, you know, who shared that knowledge across the generations. And so I think rethinking what we mean by text. And I also think our new curriculum, you know, Judy, thinking about your idea, or you're talking about policy, is that, you know, the changing curriculum across our country even. I mean, it's a changing educational landscape. And here I am promoting Indigenous literatures again, but, you know, there's a changing policy, changing educational policy landscape, and whereby ministries of education are, you know, saying we need to infuse Indigenous knowledge, content, perspectives into our curriculum. And if we look even at our new draft curriculum here in British Columbia in the Ministry of Education, you know, it's the First Peoples Principles of Learning, which are foundational values among Indigenous peoples, and they're really foundational in that curriculum. And so I think it's a really, you know, how do we support that? And libraries, you know, our school libraries have a role to play in supporting supporting those big ideas, those learning standards, the new content that we're expecting our young people to be able to take hold of. So just a few suggestions.
Okay, with that we will wrap up and again thank our distinguished panel for their contributions.